Good morning, Trailhead family. Many of you may have heard this week that in certain parts of the province, the Ontario government has begun to permit churches with their own designated spaces to gather for worship in limited numbers beginning this weekend. As of now, however, all of our past worship gathering spots, the school, the library, the Petawawa Community Center, and local parks remain closed to group gatherings. However, also beginning this weekend, the home social gathering number in this area has been raised from 5 to 10. So we may look for opportunities in the days and weeks ahead to organize some smaller gatherings of our church family together. But for today, we remain online, opening God's word with one another, lifting up our voices in singing as we seek the Lord's will in both our lives and our community. Would you please join with us now as we open our time this morning in prayer? Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. We rejoice that the number of those that are suffering and battling the virus is in decline. And Lord, we look forward to a day when we can join back together and see one another in our homes and in our church. But Lord, at this time, may we just now commit our hearts and not focus on all those other things that are happening around us, Lord, but that you would have our undivided attention. That we would be focused upon you and what you have to share with us today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
That has not proved me guilty in your sight. The best I have to offer are these filthy rags, yet you love me. All things in me call for my rejection. Acceptance. I am guilty but pardoned. By grace I've been set free. I am ransomed through the blood you shed for me. I was dead in my transgressions, but life you brought to me. I am reconciled through mercy. To the cross I cling. Cross I cling. No more am I a slave to sin, but bought with a price. Redemption that was purchased through the blessed cross that you bore for me. You bore for me. Set free. I am ransomed through the blood you shed for me. I was dead in my transgressions, but life you brought to me. I am reconciled through mercy. To the cross I cling. To the cross I cling. All things in you plead my acceptance. All things in me call for my. to me. I am reconciled to mercy, to the cross I cling, to the cross I.
Two weeks ago, in our first study from the book of Daniel together, we learned that on account of Daniel's faithfulness to the God of Israel, the Lord gave to Daniel and his friends, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, learning and skill in all literature and wisdom, with scripture noting that God had additionally given unto Daniel understanding in all visions and dreams too. And throughout the book of Daniel, in future weeks, we'll see such skills repeatedly put to the test, much as we will today in chapter 2's accounting of Daniel's interpretation of King Nebuchadnezzar's dream, a dream that acted as both a warning and a hope for the future, not just for the leadership of Babylon, nor all the heads of state throughout history and leaders of nations to this very day, but a message from the Lord that offers both a caution and a hope for even common people like us for all generations to come. Particularly as in a time such as today, when we can open our computers or turn on the television and hear of how the Prime Minister of the UK is unsure of how many children he has fathered on account of past infidelity. A time in which we can learn of a Russian president admitting to the assassination of influential political leaders on foreign soil, become introduced to a president who is actively seeking to withdraw citizenship from those in their country who don't convert to Hinduism, informed of a South Korean dictator who famously attempts to convince his populace that he has magically transcended beyond any base human function, including that of defecation, and yet another who happily endorses his own personal regimen of injecting himself with harmful disinfectant to stave off sickness and disease. That's in addition, mind you, to the many world leaders seen regularly trampling on basic human rights across this globe, and those who are guilty of unlawful imprisonment and conducting mass genocide amongst their peoples. But as I mentioned earlier, in our review of the book of Daniel today, we can turn from such discouragement and be given hope for the future, as we will learn of how all of these earthly kingdoms are but temporary. And in God's perfect timing, there would come a uniquely separate kingdom, a kingdom that will endure for all ages, ruling with glory and justice and power, a magnificent kingdom the likes of which we all can gain citizenship within. So without further delay, let's turn in our Bibles now, or swipe in your electronic devices, to the latter half of Daniel chapter 2, beginning in verse 24. Last week we learned that King Nebuchadnezzar, the ruler over all of Babylon, had been losing sleep on account of a troubling dream. So he summoned all of his enchanters and magicians and astrologers together to identify for him the meaning of this dream. But unlike times past, when King Neb told of these interpreters the contents of his dream prior to their discernment of its meaning, on this occasion, Neb demanded that they provide him both the contents of its dream and its context, to ensure for himself that they weren't just making it up as they went along, simply offering to him ego-building lies and words of corruption. And when the wise men pleaded with their king that to do what he was asking of them was beyond their capabilities, Nebuchadnezzar ordered all of the wise men of Babylon to be executed for their ineptitude. And following Nebuchadnezzar's command, the captain of the king's guard then sought out Daniel and his three companions from Judah, who most probably were still in the midst of their Babylonian training. He sought them out in order to round them up with all of the others. And learning what had angered the king, Daniel offered to be given the opportunity to personally provide answers to the king's mystery. And after being granted permission by the king to do so, Daniel takes advantage of this brief reprieve and returns to his friends and asks them to join with him in prayer that God would have mercy upon them all and graciously reveal for them the king's mystery. And that very night, God made both Nebuchadnezzar's dream and its meaning made known to Daniel in a vision. And we ended our review from the book of Daniel last week reading the words of a song of praise and thanksgiving in which Daniel offered blessings to the Lord, expressing great gratitude for both God's wisdom and the relationship that they shared. The next day, Daniel returned to the captain of the guard, announcing that he was ready to appear before the king to provide him with the answers he so desperately craved. Which leads us now to the beginning of today's passage under review, starting with verse 26 of Daniel chapter 2, where we read, "The king declared to Daniel, whose name was Belteshazzar, 'Are you able to make known to me the dream that I have seen and its interpretation?' Daniel answered the king and said, 'No wise men, enchanters, magicians, or astrologers can show to the king the mystery that the king has asked. But there is a God in heaven who reveals mysteries, and he has made known to King Nebuchadnezzar what will be in the latter days.'" And before we continue any further, let's lift up this time of study before the Lord in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you that you have just preserved it for us through all these years of history so that we can read its text, but not just see words on a page, but see your heart revealed to us. So Lord, may we be mindful of what we hold in our hands today, that this isn't just a book, but Lord, it is the very heart of God that you are sharing with us. May we approach it with reverence. May we approach it with respect. May we approach it with open ears, open minds, open hearts, so we could receive what you have to share with us today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Now to begin, Daniel ironically starts by affirming to Nebuchadnezzar that which had earlier inflamed the king with anger, as Daniel confesses that to relay to the Babylonian king both his dream and its meaning is beyond the earthly power personally held by any enchanter, magician, astrologer, or wise man in his kingdom, be they Babylonian by birth or exiles from another nation. However, before the king could have his executioner start sharpening his axe, Daniel adds, "But there is a God in heaven who could not just reveal to you this mystery, but he is actually the very source of this mystery. As it was God in heaven who enabled King Nebuchadnezzar to dream this dream so that it could be made known to him that which will occur in the future." And again, returning back to Daniel chapter 2, we read in verse 26, "The king declared to Daniel, whose name was Belteshazzar, 'Are you able to make known to me the dream that I have seen and its interpretation?' Daniel answered the king and said, 'No wise men, enchanters, magicians, or astrologers can show to the king the mystery that the king has asked. But there is a God in heaven who reveals mysteries, and he has made known to King Nebuchadnezzar what will be in the latter days. Your dream and the visions of your head as you lay in bed are these. To you, O king, as you lay in bed came thoughts of what would be after this. And he who reveals mysteries has made known to you what is to be. But as for me, this mystery has been revealed to me, not because of any wisdom that I have more than all the living, but in order that the interpretation may be made known to the king, and that you may know the thoughts of your mind.'" Daniel confesses that he had the mystery of Nebuchadnezzar's dream revealed to him by the very originator of the dream itself, surprisingly not King Neb, but the dream's source being identified as God in heaven, who personally purposed to make the Babylonian king aware of what lay ahead in future days. Daniel proceeded to recount for King Nebuchadnezzar his troubling dream, which we can personally read of ourselves in verse 31 through 45 of Daniel chapter 2. But for our purposes today, I'll ask for your permission to allow me to summarize for you all both Neb's dream and Daniel's explanation of his meaning. But that doesn't mean that you can't go back and read through the rest of Daniel chapter 2 on your own, either later today or sometime this week in its entirety. With the king unquestionably waiting with great expectation for the answer to his sleepless nights, Daniel offers that in his troubling dream, the king of Babylon saw the great image of a mighty, exceedingly bright, frightening and intimidating statue. This immense statue's head being crafted of gold, its chest and arms being made of silver, its waist and thighs constructed of bronze, and the statue's legs were made of iron, with feet a mixture of both iron and clay. And Daniel continued to share that as Neb looked on from the safety of his dream, a stone not cut by human hands, and that's not to say that this was a cosmic meteorite, but rather it's an implication that this rock was of a divine origin. This large stone sent from above struck the statue's feet, breaking them into pieces. No longer able to effectively support the rest of the enormous effigy's weight, all of the other parts of the statue began to collapse and become broken up into tiny pieces themselves, its parts resembling the fine chaff or the dust found on the wheat threshing floors of summer, allowing the wind that was present to easily carry all evidence of the once magnificent statue's remains away, so not a single trace of the once dominant structure could be possibly found. But this divinely cut stone, the one that struck the statue and initiated its collapse, remained behind, becoming a large, permanent mountain that filled the whole earth. And having shared with Nebuchadnezzar the contents of the dream, Daniel then begins to describe its meaning, but not before first addressing Nebuchadnezzar as the King of Kings, labeling him at present as the most prominent king among all human earthly kings. Perhaps he said this in an effort to respectively soften the blow of what was about to be revealed, as Daniel adds that the God of heaven, the source of this dream, who has himself given unto Nebuchadnezzar the kingdom, the power, the might, and the glory, and additionally into the king's hand, the same God has also given, wherever they may dwell, be they present citizens of Babylon or not, he has given to him the children of man, the beasts of the field, and the birds of the air. It is God, not Babylon's might, that has made it possible for Neb to rule over them all. And it is Neb himself, Daniel explains, who is being personally represented by the statue's head of gold. Gold, the most valuable mineral used in the construction of this statue to craft its arguably most prominent feature, its head. Now that's something Neb can get behind, him being head and shoulders above the rest, quite literally. And then a lesser kingdom than that of Babylon, one that is represented by the statue's chest and arms crafted in silver, will rise up against Babylon. And even Nebuchadnezzar is not so arrogant as to think that he would live forever. So perhaps he reasons that Babylon's eventual fall would likely occur under somebody else's watch. After all, he's the head of gold. And then a third kingdom, one represented by the statue's waist and thighs crafted of bronze, will rise up after that, taking their rightful position in ruling over all the earth. And finally, there shall be a fourth kingdom, one that is as strong as iron, a kingdom that breaks and shatters all things. And this kingdom will break and shatter, eliminating all kingdoms that came before it. But the inclusion of the clay embedded within the statue's feet causes the iron's stronger qualities to become weakened, much in the way of internal division. And just as iron mixed with clay will be partly strong and partly brittle, this last nation will mix with one another in marriage, their actions and motivations rooted in selfish pleasure. And this fourth kingdom will not hold together any better than the physical combination of iron mixed with clay. And during the individual dominance of these many separate kingdoms, the God of heaven, the very same God who placed this dream in Neb's mind and from whom Daniel's interpretation of it all originates, this God will set up a kingdom of his own, one that shall never be destroyed or be given up to another kingdom in defeat. But rather, there will come a stone, one that was cut from a mountain by no human hand, a rock of divine origin that will soundly break to pieces all of the other kingdoms represented in the statue, bringing them to a complete and utter end, causing their influence and impact upon the earth to completely fade and disappear, while this rock alone will stand forever. And given the events of human history, Old Testament scholars and historians alike have been able to piece together and themselves discern the events of Neb's dream, identifying particulars that were still within Babylon's future, but are now very much a part of our past. While Daniel himself identifies the immense statue's head as Babylon, it is understood that the kingdom that first succeeded it was the Medo-Persian Empire, a succession that was nearer to the present than Nebuchadnezzar may have thought. In fact, we're told as much back in the closing verse of Daniel chapter 1, when we're told that Daniel would remain in Babylon until the first year of the rule of Cyrus. What it doesn't say there on the page, however, but would have been common knowledge to the original Hebrew audience of the book of Daniel, was that Cyrus was the king of Persia, the king who was integral to Babylon's own collapse, thus meaning the end of Babylon's reign would occur within Daniel's own lifetime. And following Babylon's defeat, the Medo-Persian Empire would rule for over two centuries before themselves falling victim to the Greeks, who were led by Alexander the Great, who had aspirations to conquer the whole world. But the Greek rule, albeit a powerful one, wouldn't even last as long as its predecessors. As after about 185 years, less than four generations by ancient Near East standards, Greek rule would be replaced by that of Rome, one of history's strongest and most powerful empires, its lasting influence still felt across the globe today. But as the saying goes, the bigger they are, the harder they fall. As this final collapse, the fall of Rome, the collapse that toppled the entire statue in Nebuchadnezzar's dream, was initiated by a rock that laid to waste all of the other earlier kingdoms in order to lay a proper foundation for a kingdom of no earthly origin, but rather a kingdom set up and prepared for by the Lord, a kingdom that is built entirely upon the work of God's own Son, Jesus Christ, which is precisely why Jesus himself referenced Daniel's earlier writings from here in chapter 2 when he taught of the parable of the wicked tenants. The New Testament Gospel of Luke records a parable wherein Jesus uses the illustration of a man who planted a vineyard and leased its use to tenants while he was out of the area. And in his absence, This landowner elected to send one of his servants to collect some of the fruits of the vineyard. But upon the steward's arrival to the vineyard, the landowner's representative would instead receive a brutal beating from the Lord's land's tenants and be sent home empty-handed. And after 3 unsuccessful attempts to collect fruit and 3 successive beatings by the tenants of his servants, the landowner chose to personally send his own beloved son, concluding that the tenants would certainly have to accept and treat respectfully the landowner's own heir. But the tenants selfishly acted to instead murder the son, determining that left without an heir, the landowner's inheritance would then become theirs. And Jesus concluded this parable, offering to those listening that the landowner would respond to his son's murder, an act of blatant disregard of the landowner himself, by utterly destroying the existing tenants and giving the remaining vineyards to others. Explaining this rationale by quoting first from Psalm 118, verse 22, when he said, "What then is this that is written? The stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone." Before then, alluding to this very passage from Daniel, saying, "Everyone who falls on that stone will be broken to pieces, and when it falls on anyone, it will crush him." At the time of its teaching, many in attendance were likely as confounded by Christ's words as Nebuchadnezzar was himself by his own puzzling dream. But having the broader scope of the scriptures available to us now, and the fuller story of the redemptive plan of the Lord, we can rightly conclude that the landowner in question represented the God of Israel, and those to whom he had allowed access to his vineyards were earthly leaders, those who disregarded and ignored his authority. Their physical abuse of his representatives and eventual murder of his son, leading to their own ultimate destruction. As for Daniel and King Nebuchadnezzar, the arrival of this rock was still yet in the future. But for us, the rock's arrival lay both in our past and our future, as when this cornerstone, God's own son, Jesus Christ, descended from heaven to earth, his life, death, and resurrection inaugurated God's kingdom. A kingdom, however, that will not yet become fully realized until a time in the future when Jesus Christ arrives on this planet for a second time with a new purpose. On the day of final judgment, when sin will be completely expunged from all of creation, and God's glory expands permanently, like that stone that evolved into a mountain, spreading over all the earth forever and ever. As earthly kingdoms will inevitably rise and fall, but God's kingdom will one day rise to reign for all time. Nebuchadnezzar's dream, both recounted for him and adequately interpreted, after hearing and becoming certain of what the God of heaven had revealed to Daniel in a vision, the king of Babylon, he fell down on his face and paid tribute to God's representative before him, announcing that Daniel's God is the God of all gods, declaring that Daniel's God is Lord over all of the earth's kings, himself included. And this God is a revealer of mysteries, who this day enabled Daniel to reveal this troubling mystery to the Babylonian king. Then, as Nebuchadnezzar had earlier promised to whomever could reveal to him both his dream and its interpretation back in verse 6 of this chapter, the king gave to Daniel high honors and many great gifts, and also unexpectedly granted him the title of ruler over the whole province of Babylon, establishing him as the head official over all of its wise men. after which Daniel successfully made one request of the king, asking for Nebuchadnezzar to appoint his faithful friends Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah in charge of the affairs of the province of Babylon too, which would also enable Daniel to remain in an influential position within the king's own court. The lesson that God aimed to make clear to Nebuchadnezzar through his dreams is the same lesson that we can all benefit from today. And that's the wisdom that all earthly endeavors, no matter how big or how small, can be brought about to dust in but an instant. As earthly kingdoms will inevitably rise and fall, but God's kingdom will one day rise to reign for all time. A kingdom that we can become forever citizens of, should we choose to repent, turn away from our sinful lives, and build our lives upon the rock, Christ the cornerstone, who acts as this eternal kingdom's foundation. Interestingly enough, we learned almost 3 months ago how much of our lives we generally took for granted. All of the places we went, all of the things that we did, fondly remembering those we could interact with and spend time amongst, even missing those who seemed to regularly get on our nerves. But back in March, with the sudden threat of COVID-19, the rug rapidly got taken out from under our feet, leaving many of us across this world reeling, struggling to keep our balance. When the Israelites strayed from the Lord and departed from their devotion of him, acting disobediently, worshiping other gods and idols, disregarding and outright rejecting the Lord's commands, God would allow them a taste of what it was like to be absent from his providence and care, by giving them into the hands of their enemies, much like how he gave the southern kingdom of Judah into the hands of Babylon. And while in exile, many of God's people longed to return home and recommit their lives to the Lord. But in time, even after being graciously granted their freedom, their repeated selfish attitudes would return and cause them to sinfully stray once more. And while none of us have been forcibly removed from our homes, given this extra time of isolated reflection, I believe we've each probably grown to develop a greater appreciation of that which we had. And moving forward, I would hope that we won't ever approach these regular activities in quite the same way ever again. And that includes worshiping and serving the Lord within a supportive community of believers, while reaching out in love to all those around us. And this comes to mind today, in particular at this time, when I think of the many believers and Christ followers who have been petitioning the government of late to reopen churches for corporate worship. And I couldn't help but notice the absence of other voices in the discussion, leading one to ask, are churches today more engaged in polishing the statue than actively looking for and warning people of the imminent rock? If churches, and I include Trailhead amongst that number, if we did a better job of serving the community around us, if we were more active in the effort of reaching out in love to those who need to receive Christ, that it wouldn't just be those who attend church who are crying out for them to become reopened. Our voices would be joined by those in the community, the very people who are blessed, encouraged, supported, and rescued from the darkness. They would share in our mourning of its absence. If something goes wrong this weekend, and the Ontario government rescinds their okay for church families to gather together physically in worship, or worse yet, let's use our imagination. What if churches across the Ottawa Valley were ordered closed for a period of 1 year beginning tomorrow? Would the community around us notice our absence? Would people outside of the church be negatively impacted at all? Would they even care? We at Trailhead accept that the church isn't a building, that the body of Christ isn't built of brick and mortar, but is formed out of the followers of Jesus Christ. But is our gospel presence impacting the community around us? Or has it become increasingly absent as well? Not just in these recent months, but even before the outbreak began. As church families prepare for the opportunity to gather together in worship once more, it will be undoubtedly with much change. Things will not necessarily be as they once were. And that's not necessarily a bad thing. That is, if we spend this present time in thoughtful reflection and prayer, considering how we can better serve our Lord by more effectively serving and loving the community around us. Most importantly, by sharing with them of the rock that will not fail them. By God's grace and in His perfect timing, may we not just return back to our normal practices, but may we return as a church family renewed with an impassioned spirit that just simply seeks to do better. When I think of the sudden, uninspected collapse of many of these powerful historic empires, I become more and more mindful that we all ought to live each day as though it were our last, taking advantage of every opportunity that God puts before us to faithfully serve Him. Additionally, ensuring that we have found a home in God's eternal kingdom and are not still firmly rooted in the one destined for collapse, so that we might actively be ever and always sharing of the good news of the saving work of Jesus Christ with all those around us as we seek to praise God's name in all the earth.
Sun to the ending of the day, one name alone be praised. Every nation, tribe, and tongue, all creation lifting up, your name alone we good and you are just. One name alone be praised. From the heights and from the depths, in every heart with every breath, your name alone we raise. Our God, Every sky is filled with wonder, all creation lifting higher. The only King who reigns forever, who is like our God, who is like our God. Praise the Lord, all the earth, all the earth. Bless His name, only one name, now and always. Praise the Lord, all the earth, all the earth. Bless His name, only one name, now and always. Bless His name, only one name, now and always.
Thanks for joining us this morning online. And before we close in prayer today, may I issue to you all a bit of a challenge. This week, please take some time to prayerfully consider the past and present impact of both our church and our church family on the community around us, with a mind to consider how we can do better in the future. So long as there are people on this earth, there are many among us who have yet to hear and receive the good news of Jesus Christ. What can we do as a church family, acting together as the body of Christ, to more effectively bring the gospel to others in the days and weeks ahead? It may require that we think outside of the box, and perhaps even do something we've never done before. But there may never be a better time than now to reset, refocus, and reposition ourselves to more effectively reach the lost. Will you please pray with me? Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day and the time that you have given us that we can set aside so we can devote our attention to you. But Lord, we know that there are others in this world, others in our community, our neighbors, our friends, our co-workers. Lord, who for them this is just another day. Another day where they are seeking hope, they are looking for purpose, and perhaps even wandering spiritually and emotionally. Lord, may you grant to us wisdom in these days ahead. May you provide for us opportunities in which we can share with others about the love, mercy, and grace of Jesus Christ. Lord, may we not just relax and sit back and wait for people to come to us. But Lord, may we reach out and look for opportunities. Opportunities to share, opportunities to love, opportunities to forgive, opportunities to serve you by serving your very children in this world. Lord, may you give us a mindful spirit of not just ourselves and of our church family, but the entire creation under God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. May the Lord bless and keep you and your family healthy and safe this week. Bye for now.